Thank you, Father. As we come in His presence, we are this words that we sing is not just words, it's something that resonates within each one of us. And so this morning, it is so good to see every single one of you here today. Welcome to 2024, Gate. It's going to be a great year. Let's come to the important part of this time, and it is about reading His Word. But before I read the Word, there's something that I like to actually say this morning. And I would like to make a bold statement and say that God, His silence is over. There's so many that for many days or months, even perhaps years, that have been seeking hard after Him, praying for a miracle, praying for breakthroughs. But today I would like to say that no matter, sometimes you feel like it's like a brass ceiling. He's not answering. He's so silent in the situations that we face ourselves in. But this morning, He's never left us. He's never forsaken us. And this is what I need to say to each one of us, that His silence is over. So this morning, I've got two scriptures actually that I'd like to refer to. And the first one is in the book of Kings, where we find Elijah and him running away from God after experiencing and exposing this majestic God. And then we move into the book of Mark, and we find the lady with the issue of blood pressing towards the crowd, making her way where she is, irrespective of how downtrodden or weak or feeble she is. She's making her way to touch the hem of His garment. And this morning, between the two scriptures, just a little bit of a backdrop. You know, the one thing that I've come to realize is when I search out His Word and search Him, is that God never moves in our crisis or in our situations. He moves by our faith. And those crises and the situations that we find ourselves in is actually something that moves us into the proximity of this great God. So this morning, let us turn to the first scripture, and we can find ourselves either in the book of Kings today, or we can find ourselves in the book of Mark. And let's go to the book of Kings. So we are reading from 1 Kings chapter 9, and from verse 19. And the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in that earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled the cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Now we move to Mark chapter 5, and we're reading from verses 5. Chapter 5 from verse 24. A large crowd followed and pressed around him, and a woman was there who had been subjected to the bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of the doctors, and she had spent all that she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up from behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I shall be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt her body and that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that the power has gone out from him. He turned around in the crowds and he asked, who touched my clothes? You see the people crowding against you, said his disciples, and yet you ask who touched me? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, who knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, she told him the whole truth. He said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. When Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. Your daughter is dead, they said. Why bother the teacher anymore? Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, don't be afraid, just believe. So today, the faith that we have within us is the faith that will displace fear, will displace our uncertainties, will display our brokenness. It will display all anxiousness and anxieties. And as we step into 2024, we step in based on the promises that we have and based on the fact that we need to realize this covenant that we have with a true and a living Savior. You know, I don't know where we are today, this morning, but I know we are in the right place. I know we are in the right, we are positioned correctly. So let us bow our heads and pray and just call upon God. And this morning it mustn't just be we praying for the sake of praying, but let it be a condition of our heart, a prayer, an urgency that comes from the very fibers of our being. Father, most gracious God, a living God, we come before you. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh upon us this morning. Holy Spirit, we invite you in this place that you would charge this very atmosphere this morning, O God. And Father, as we come before you, we thank you that this morning we have that promise that the silence is over and we have stepped into, O God, the fullness of your promises, the fullness, O Father, of where we need to be with you. This morning, O God, as you have given us open heaven, I ask, O God, that you would speak within each one of us. Speak to us, O God. Father, this morning, O God, when you speak, the blind, O God, sees. When you speak, the mountains are removed. And Father, when you speak, the storms are calmed down, O God. Even in our lives, O God, when you speak, O God, we have that assurance, we have that peace, O God, that no man understands, O God. But this morning, O Father, we ask, O God, that you speak. So speak to each one of us, O God. Help us to know and have our being in you, to know, O God, your voice this day, O Lord. And Father, quicken each one of us, O God, no matter where we find ourselves, O God, no matter the brokenness, O God. But this morning, when you speak, O Father, you speak, O God, life in every situation that we find ourselves, that which the cankerworm and the caterpillar, the locust, oh God, has come to rob, oh God, this morning, Father, when you speak, it shall be restored, oh God. Father, this morning, oh God, every weapon that is formed against us, because you have spoken, oh God, it shall not stand, oh God. And Father, this morning, oh Father, we come before you. Come before you as your sons, O God. Come before you, O Father, because you never, O God, you never leave us. You never forsake us. Even when we are at our worst, O God, you are with us. So this day, O Lord, let us not just come here and come before you, O God, with hearts of thanksgiving, O God. And Father, this morning, even as we continue in this place, O God, charged, O Father, with your very presence, this morning, O Father, as we lift our hands and raise our voices before you, O God, in praise and in adoration, Our worship is not only in song, oh God, but our worship is our very lives, oh God. So this morning, oh God, we ask that you go before us. We ask, oh God, that your presence, oh Father, will dispel every other thing, oh God, that's not meant to be here, oh God, in Jesus' name. So right now, Father, we just want to say that it's such a joy and such a privilege to be found in you. For we ask all these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, family. It's so wonderful that we can rejoice and be glad in his presence. Amen. Won't you just greet somebody next to you and welcome them into your Father's house? We just thank him for his amazing grace, for all that he has done, because worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us.
Who is the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who conquered the grave?
come and do whatever you want to do, Father. We surrender our lives unto you, O God. We just bless your name, O God.
To do whatever you want to do whatever. I surrender.
nothing else but you, Jesus. Nothing else will satisfy us. Nothing else will do, oh God, but you, Father.
Father, the songs that we have sung have clearly expressed our intentions, our desires, our hope that our lives would be surrendered to you, that your presence will become the place that we choose to dwell, and that our whole lives will exist in you. There's no better place, no safer place. There's no place that can give us comfort or encouragement but in you. So today, Father, hear our prayers. We are weak, vulnerable, and so many of us are challenged. The world is in turmoil. Gross darkness covers the earth. There's so much of evil all around us. We do not know where to turn. So the only place we can be is in you. Like David, we want to learn how to lift up our eyes unto the hills. Lift up our eyes unto the Lord, for you are our helper, a present help in times of trouble. You are like the mountains that surrounded Jerusalem. We find security in you. You are the only one that can give us answers, because you are the God of all wisdom and counsel. In you is understanding. There is nothing that we need that is outside of you. And today, as we are recalibrating, resetting, refocusing, help us to be a submissive people. We do not want to be recalcitrant like the nations of the world. We do not want to be in rebellion or insubordinate. We want to serve you, Father. We want to serve you from the depths of our hearts. We want to serve you with everything we have. There is nothing else that is of value but you, only you, only you. So teach us today to have hearts that will believe. Help us to put our confidence in you. May we trust you in everything, even though at times it may not make sense to us. Help us, Lord, not to be in rebellion to your ways. And so I pray for this house, for this family, for us as a congregation, as we enter the new year, as we are in the first month of the new year. Help us, Lord, to number our days and teach us wisdom in these times, that we will know how to manage the time that we live in, that these days will be days in which our steps will be defined by the lamp of God, the word of God, that our ways will be the way of God, our mind will be the mind of God, and everything we do will be to bring pleasure and honor to your name. So I bless this house today, Father. I pray that because we have devoted our lives to you, favor will come upon this house, great grace will come upon your people, and that there will be joy unspeakable amongst us, and your joy will be our strength. So Father, I thank you that in this year we will see divine interventions, divine manifestations. We will see miracles. We will see interventions in ways that we've not seen before. That in the midst of impossibilities, we will see the supernatural. We will see the possible. So I'm praying that healings will take place amongst us, O God. Breakthroughs will take place. Divine provisions will happen. And where possible, angelic interventions will become a natural manifestation. That I pray for in this time. And I thank you, Father, that because we have submitted ourselves to you and to your government, there will be everlasting peace amongst us, and your grace will be sufficient. So I bless your people. Bless your people. I bless them with the Melchizedek blessings. I bless them with the blessings that Christ has given to us in heavenly places. Blessings that make rich and add no sorrow. I bless your people. And I thank you, Father, that we will walk in favor and in grace and in the strength of the Holy Spirit. I bless your name. Blessed be your name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Come on, say it like you believe it. Amen. Amen. Well, greet each other around you. I know you've done that, but do it again. Just feel comfortable with each other. Thank you. Good morning. Good to see all of you. I can't say welcome to the first service because I was not there at the first one. But welcome to Gate Ministry Santon. Good to feel the vibe in the house, to sense the excitement amongst you, and listening to the chatter pre-service has been so encouraging because you could just feel that there's an excitement in the atmosphere. Isn't it good to be in an environment that's convivial, that's exciting? It feels like there's a festive feeling amongst us. And where grace abounds, joy manifests. And the joy of the Lord is a gift from God. It's got nothing to do with the emotive state of our being. It's got to do with the presence of grace in our spirits. And when that it becomes a compound, a composite manifestation, then joy is in the place, and the joy of the Lord is our strength. Outside of God's joy, there's no peace, there's no rest, and you won't even get sleep. But when you have God's joy, all of these things become a reality. I'm looking forward to the year ahead of us. I've said that, I think, to our staff. It's going to be a very, very exciting year. Not without challenges. I didn't say a trouble-free year. What I said was that it'll be a year in which we will see God manifest. When sin, darkness, and confusion proliferates, that's when we will see God increase His presence amongst His people. Great light will come upon each one of us as we align ourselves to His eternal purposes. So while there's a lot of negativity in the world, the church has to learn how to keep their faith in Him, like we heard read for us this morning. And Jesus said that when He does come, will He find faith in the world? And faith is not positive thinking, but faith is placing one's confidence in the God that they serve. Faith is believing in Him, not believing for things, but believing in Him in which consist all things. And He is the one that will watch us, cover us, protect us, preserve us, and know how best to give us the things that we need when we need them most. And so our trust has to be in Him. And He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him, not things. So my prayer for us is that in the year ahead, we will prepare ourselves to serve God. And let me tell you, there's no peace. There's no satisfaction. There's absolutely no feeling of completion without learning how to live or to give your lives completely to the Lord Himself. And I want to encourage us with that at the beginning of 2024. This is a very important year in the calendar of Gate Ministry Sandton. But it's also a very important year within this present epoch, which we refer to as a kairos. And the kairos has been given a name, the apostolic season, because this year, 2024, will be exactly 30 years for the apostolic season that has been promulgated by us and others of our of different streams globally. This is about the 30th year. Marol and I started in 1994 when God said there will be God instructed us to consider joining a season that will bring a breath of fresh air to traditional Christianity, and He said that He wants to bring reformation and fine-tunement to the church. We didn't understand the terminology that was given to us then, but 30 years later, we're beginning to see a much fuller picture of what God is doing, not just in this country, but globally. And there is a very powerful move taking place amongst churches in the global context. But this year for Gate Ministry, Sandton is also 12 years. So the number 12, the number 30, are very powerful words in biblical geometrics or numerology. And you know, God is found in numbers. That's why God is not only referred to in the alphabets, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, but He's also the first and the last. He's referring to a numerical system, a sequence of how he reveals Himself. So God reveals Himself in names, in numbers, in alphabets, in types, in shadows, and the number 12, the number 30, and many other numbers in the scriptures speak significantly. 12 speaks about governmental order, apostolic structure, and a kind of a seamless organization in God. And then number 30 speaks about maturation. It speaks about being commissioned into ministry. And I think there's a lot of things organically and structurally that are being put together. And globally, there is a mature church emerging. And that church may be very insignificant when you think about the kind of communities and kingdoms we live in. But that church is going to be like a David that will bring down the colossal systems of the world, the gigantic systems that seems to be overwhelming and prevailing over the nations. And so I think we're seeing something very powerful happening. And obviously, here in South Africa, this year, 2024 is 30 years exactly for the democracy of our country. And there's so much of chaos in the politics of our country, but we're hoping that true democracy will come through the divine kingdom of God. And God will bring order and structure and direction. So this, you know, the numbers are lining up. And the scriptures seem to very poignantly showing us that something powerful is going to happen in the earth. And so I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but I feel impregnated, impregnant with expectation, with anticipation. And I want to say to all of us here today, if your lamps are empty of oil or half filled, fill them up. Learn from the virgins that had their lamps filled and their wicks trimmed. Do not be caught empty or incomplete when the Lord comes. How the Lord is coming, you know, is subject to how we read the scriptures, but the Lord is coming. And we are living in perilous times. These are difficult days. And the best place to be is to be in His presence and to choose to live a devoted, surrendered, submitted life to the will of God. That's the kind of person that God wants in the earth today. So say to your neighbor, this is an exciting time. And if you've been stuck in a place for too long and you've lived there for too long, it's time to move to a better place in God. And these are the choices that each one of us would need to make presently. So that sounded like a sermon. But that was because I wasn't here for the last couple of services. Now, I know that the message has been entitled, and our graphics team have put together a title called Overcoming the Amorite Spirit or something like that. What? Overcoming the Amorite Spirit. But what I want to share with you is more than just overcoming the Amorite spirit. Obviously, God dropped this thought into my heart towards the end of last year, and I found that it interconnected very powerfully with a prophetic word that we received on the 1st of January 2023, where God said that the church is being released or commissioned or launched into a season of aggressive advancement. And we've seen some very powerful things happen from the beginning of January 2023 until now, where some great advancements have taken place by individuals and by others, by churches and by networks and so forth in the global context. And I've been astounded to see some of the advancements that have taken place. But I found that what God dropped into my spirit towards the end of last year, and I started to share my seed thoughts. They were unpolished, very rough, but I just thought that I should scatter it, just release it. But obviously over the December period and now into January, they are getting fine-tuned, and I'm beginning to see a bigger picture. And I'm beginning to understand the way of God, and what God is doing, is going to do corporately in the church globally. And I want to share some of that. And the book that I've been dwelling in, meditating, musing upon, is the book of Deuteronomy, very powerful book. And there's various definitions to the name Deuteronomy. One means the law explained or expounded a second time. Others say that it is a copy of the law. So the book of Deuteronomy has various meanings, subject to interpretation and commentary. But the book of Deuteronomy is a very powerful book in that through the narrative of Moses, when he presents the history of the journey of the nation of Israel from Jerusalem from Egypt into the promised land, he helps us to have insights into how God deals with a people. But in gleaning from those insights, we also learn how that which happened within a certain context can be applicable to this present time that we live in. Because nothing that God gives us in Scripture is just supposed to be related to the time in which it was given to us. All of Scripture is for our learning, for our education, for our studying. It is to inform us on how we need to apply the lessons from that period of time into our present context. And without wanting to get too academic here, to read the Scripture, you have to have a toolbox. And the toolbox is called a hermeneutical toolbox. And part of your hermeneutics is that you have to have the right tools in that box to know how to read the Scriptures, interpret it in the period in which it was given to us. And secondly, to understand the content of the context in which the Scriptures have been given to us. And that's called exegesis. And that's a tool, that's a skill. Not all of us have been trained to understand that. That's why you come to a place like this, to read the Bible, not devotionally, but to read it in an informed way, in a way that you can understand it, so that it does not just become primitive literature that is subjected to antiquity, but you can understand it on how God, who is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, a God who is immutable, who does not change, the God that deals with people in a primitive past, can also deal with us in a very contemporary and maybe a sophisticated present, because we live in a much more advanced world than the people in yesteryear. But God is the same. And how he deals with them does not mean that he's going to change his way of dealing with us. He may upgrade methodologies, but he does not upgrade principles. Principles are always the same. The Word of God is the same. That's why this Bible, which could contain over 4,000 years of history, is relative to us today as it is yesterday. And that's why the Bible is so powerful, and it can be the absolute standard to our lives. And God chooses to come to people on different levels, speaking to them his ways, his counsels, even though he may use different methodologies to do so. And we've discussed this, for example, Hebrews chapter 1, God who in sundry times and in diverse ways, I'm using King James language here, spoke to the fathers in the prophets, or through the prophets, some scriptures would say. In other words, God used the medium of prophetic agency to speak to the leaders of different communities in different periods of time. But the word spoke is the word lalio. And that word is a word that speaks, that describes or depicts the level of linguistic engagement. Simply meaning that if a person is of a certain intellectual quotient, God will not come to the person on his superior intelligence, but he would come on the level of the person's intellect, and God will speak to them. For example, if God came here and needed to speak to a little baby, like a Samuel in the temple, he's not going to use heavy language. He's going to speak to Samuel on the level that little boy Samuel will understand. And so he'll use that language. It does not mean that God is of that level, but he comes down to that level. So when we read the book of Deuteronomy, yeah, you will see that God uses, you know, methodologies or narratives that are so simple that sometimes we could miss it because we're trying to see it from our sophistication or from our intellectual abilities, which could be far more superior than previous generations. But God still speaks. And God speaks to, and I wish I could say that God speaks to us more intelligently in this season, because when it comes to our spiritual quotient, sometimes it's not compatible with our intellectual quotient. And our spiritual quotient, you could have all the PhDs in the world. You could write the most powerful journals, and you could make great contributions to a certain field of expertise. And yet when it comes to spiritual things, we could still be in diapers. We could still be little children being breastfed instead of eating the chunks of meat that God wants to give us. So we have to choose today on which level we want to hear God speak. But the book of Deuteronomy is a book where it captures in a very summarized way the journey of the nation of Israel from Egypt to the Promised Land. And it's a fascinating journey in which, through studying the nation of Israel, we come to understand how we are to live our lives as the new Israel of God. By now you would know that God's purposes are not fulfilled through what's happening in natural Israel. While God has made physical promises to the father of natural Israel, Abraham, and said to them very clearly, I'm going to give you this piece of land in the Middle East. And that land is being fought about right now. And while there are promises to natural Israel, that's why they've been protected, they've been preserved, sometimes when they didn't even deserve it, like because of God's faithfulness. But the promises of God are not only to natural Israel. In the new covenant, the promises of God are to spiritual Israel. And according to Galatians chapter 3, if you are Abraham's seed, and if you are carrying the seed of Christ, then you are the new Israel of God. So in Christ, the church is God's Israel, God's heavenly Jerusalem, God's city that comes out of God from the heavens. And in Christ, whatever God has done to natural Israel is a lesson for spiritual Israel. And while God has given them a small piece of land in the Middle East, God has given us the right to rule over the earth. In Jesus, he said, go into all the world. That's what Jesus said. And make disciples. Implying, bring back dominion to the entire world. So the mandate of the church is to reach the whole world. Are you with me? And that mandate is given to all of us. So when we study the book of Deuteronomy, we are studying how from natural history, we can glean lessons that can help us with our present spiritual journey in God. And if you can practice that, implement it, install it into your lives, then I guarantee you that the God who blessed natural Israel is the same God who will bless you. And what God said to Abraham If you cannot count the stars of the sky, and he compared what he wants to do with Abraham to the stars of the sky. He said, and you know, just recently they discovered another constellation out there that is going to even break the whole study of astronomy and so forth. And they are now saying there are so many more undiscovered galaxies. And God said, if you can count the stars of the sky, your children will be like that. In other words, so innumerable, so immeasurable, so powerful that they will shape the destiny of nations. And that's the kind of people that we, the Church of Jesus Christ, should be. Are you understanding me? So while there are natural prophecies, I mean, there are prophecies that will come to natural nations like Israel in the Middle East, and God's also given other nations in the world, you know, promises. And you can read Jeremiah and Isaiah and the other prophets in the scriptures, including Abraham. You will find that God has promised to bless many nations, but the true blessings of God are for those who are in Christ. Blessings that make rich and add no sorrow. And that's you and me. We're a highly favored people, more than the church can ever understand. One of the greatest tragedies in the church presently is that people do not believe the word of God. They do not believe what God has intended for them. Like we read in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, that the thoughts that God has for us are for our benefit. I mean, his thoughts are always for us. Everything is created is for you and for me. But the reality, and this is what Deuteronomy will tell us, and I'll read the chapter for us shortly. The reality is that if the people only believed, if they only accepted, the journey from Egypt to the promised land would be 11 days. Think about it. And at the end of 40 years, Moses is saying to them, what you could have done in 11 days, you're only beginning now, 40 years later. How many of us have been saved, brought into the church, taught the word, and we still believe, we still live with unbelief, disobedience, rebellion. We think God is against us. In fact, that's the scriptures I will read for you. And as a result of it, God says, okay, if you want to choose your way, then I withdraw. And then when we choose our way, we live in the wilderness of desolation, of destitution, of a lack of increase and fruitfulness and prosperity and blessings and so forth. And whose fault is it ultimately? It's the fault of those who choose to live in unbelief. So I want to stir up faith amongst us, because I really believe that this is an opportune time to see the unprecedented blessings of God fall upon us in ways that we've not experienced. Are you with me? Let's read Deuteronomy chapter 1. We'll read the whole chapter. I'm going to lay this as a background to some of the things I want to tell you. And obviously, my ultimate objective is to get to the spirit of Amorite, to understand the Amorite kingdom, and to understand, to study two kings within this constellation of people, two very powerful kings. And the Amorite spirit is a powerful spirit that you must overcome before you can get to your promises. If this spirit is not overcome, you cannot acquire the promises of God. And this spirit is the first spirit you conquer before you possess. And the Amorite spirit speaks about a spirit that is represented by a people that has physique, that are called giants. They are physically huge individuals, but more than that, they were very powerful people. They were mountain dwellers. Symbolically, mountain dwellers are people that have dominion, that live above the rest. They were people also, the Amorite was known, the Amorite means the sayer, somebody who is a publicist, one who eloquently communicates his ideology and philosophy. In fact, the Amorites, according to Bible commentators, were called the Westerners. I don't have to draw a comparison today, but Western nations seem to believe they are more cultured, refined, sophisticated, educated, and very polished in their ideologies, and so self-opinionated that they have created ideologies like modernism and postmodernism. And we know the challenges that those ideologies or philosophies have given to us in the world. And all of that is in the Bible, hidden. Hidden in the meaning of names, because God is in the detail. God is in the iota. You know, he's in the abbreviation. As I said to you early on, he's in the alphabet, he's in the number, he's in the shadow. He's even hidden himself in the names he gives us. Like the name Jesus means to save. That's it's not a coincidence. It's a calculated statement. You know, when God gives you a name, in that name is hidden certain characteristic features. So when we read the scriptures here, you discover some very, very powerful things. Let's read. These are the words Moses spoke to all Israel in the wilderness east of the Jordan. That is, in the Arabah, opposite Suf, between Paran and Tophel, Laban, Hezra, Rot, and Dizahab. It takes 11 days to go from Horeb to Kadesh Barnea by the mountain Seir Road. 11 days to get to the place from which God would have launched a program of conquest. But in the 40th year, listen to this, in the 40th year, on the first day of the 11th month, Moses proclaimed to the Israelites all that the Lord had commanded him concerning them. This is 40 years later. This he did, listen to this, after he had defeated Sihon, king of the Amorites. He could only start to share with the nation of Israel everything that God wanted him to tell them after he conquered a king called Sihon of the Amorites who reigned in Heshbon. All these names are loaded with secrets. And at Edrei, had defeated Og, another powerful king, king of Bashan, who reigned in Ashtaroth. These both kings were Amorites. Both of them were Amorites. East of the Jordan, in the territory of Moab, Moses began to expound this law, saying, now listen very carefully. The Lord your God said to us at Oreb, you have stayed long enough at this mountain. Break camp and advance into the hill country of the Amorites. Go to all the neighboring peoples in the Arabah. Now God told them this at the beginning of their journey. In the mountains, in the western hills, foothills, in the Negev. I'm reading from the New King, the NIV. Sorry, I should have told you that. NIV. And along the coast to the land of the Canaanites and to Lebanon, as far as the great river, the Euphrates. See, listen, I've given you this land. Go in and take possession of the land the Lord swore he would give to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob, and to their descendants after them. At that time I said to you, you are too heavy a burden for me to carry alone. The Lord your God has increased your numbers so that today you are as numerous as the stars in the sky. May the Lord, the God of your ancestors, increase you 1,000 times and bless you as he has promised. Now, this is all the things that God wants to do with us. But how can I bear your problems and your burdens and your disputes all by myself? Choose some wise, understanding, and respected men from each of your tribes, and I will set them over you. You answered me, what you propose to do is good. So I took the leading men of your tribes, wise and respected men, and appointed them to have authority over you as commanders of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens, and as tribal officials. And I charge your judges at that time, hear the disputes between your people and judge fairly, whether the case is between two Israelites or between an Israelite and a foreign resident amongst you. Do not show partiality in judging. Hear both small and great alike. Do not be afraid of anyone, for judgment belongs to God. Bring me any case too hard for you, and I will hear it. And at that time, I told you everything you were to do. Very powerful things. We're not going to discuss that today. Then as the Lord our God commanded us, we went out from Horeb and went towards the hill country of the Amorites through all the vast and dreadful wilderness that you have seen. And so we reached Kadesh Barnea. Then I said to you, you have reached the hill country of the Amorites, which the Lord our God is giving us. See, the Lord your God has given you the land. Go up and take possession of it as the Lord, the God of your ancestors told you. Listen to these words. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Then all of you came to me and said, let us send men ahead to spy out the land for us and bring back a report about the route we are to take, and the towns we will come to. The idea seemed good to me, so I selected 12 of you, one man from each tribe. They left and went up into the hill country and came to the valley of Eshcol and explored it. Taking with them some of the fruit of the land, they brought it down to us and reported, it is a good land that the Lord our God is giving us. But listen to these words. But you were unwilling to go up. You rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God. You grumbled in your tents and said, the Lord hates us. So he brought us out of Egypt to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us. Where can we go? Our brothers have made our hearts melt in fear. They say the people are stronger and taller than we are. The cities are large, with walls up to the sky. We even saw the Anakites there, giants there. And I said to you, do not be terrified, do not be afraid of them. The Lord your God, who is going before you, will fight for you, as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. And in the wilderness, there you saw how the Lord your God carried you, as a father carries his son. All the way you went until you reached this place. In spite of this, you did not trust in the Lord your God, who went ahead of you on the journey in fire by night and in a cloud by day to search out places for you to camp and to show you the way you should go. When the Lord heard what you said, he was angry and solemnly swore. No one, listen to me, no one from this evil generation shall see the good land I swore to give your ancestors, except Caleb, son of Jephunneh. He will see it, and I will give him and his descendants the land he set his feet on, because he followed the Lord wholeheartedly, wholeheartedly. Say to your neighbor, wholeheartedly. This is not selectively. This is not redacting the scriptures to choose what you want. This is not going to a restaurant and choosing an a la carte meal. This is wholehearted, totally. This is something people don't want. and see why you stay in the wilderness. Why no breakthroughs? See why sometimes you feel God left you, abandoned you. It's not because God is a God that does not love, but it's because God is a God of free will. God respects people with moral choice. God respects the decisions of others, heads of families. And if people say, no, we don't think we can take them. The opposition is too great. This world system is too difficult. You know, I'd rather bow to the pressure at work than stand up like a Daniel. This is the problem. And this for me is struck home because I'm asking myself over and over again, why are some people breaking through and others not? Why are some blessed and others not blessed? How is it that God is favoring some and not favoring others? And I realize that it's not God. It's us. Like we heard in the invocation by Malini today. Do we really trust Him? Can we hold on to His word? If we perish, we perish. That's the kind of mentality. You know, can He fail? Would He be able to reduce Himself if He is part of the unchangeable, the, you know, God is immutable. God is the same. Can He change? Can we come in this very developed world where they teach you about self-preservation? They teach you about how you have to care for yourself because no one will be there to care for you. They teach you to become an individual rather than belong to a community that can trust. Can you in this world come to a place of saying, I will trust God? And believe that like a father carries a child, He will carry you. Like a father cares for a child, He will care for you. If it means that He must produce a pillar of fire at night and a cloud in the heat of the day to give you shade, but you will trust Him. This is the book of Deuteronomy. I can go to the Amorites and I want to talk about it. It's actually profound. But I can't talk about the Amorites unless you understand that you have to first put your trust in God. You know, you can get saved, like Pastor Chris preached for the last two messages. But if you've not worked out your salvation, if you've not come to understand that your foundation has to be compact and secure in the knowledge that He didn't take you out of Egypt from the bondage of Pharaoh to leave you to your own destiny, but He took you from Pharaoh's bondage so that He could become your father. And that you have to learn how to trust Him and not put your trust in something else. You know, David put it like this because he lived in the day of chariots and horses. They measured military strength by chariots and horses, by the strength of a man's legs, because that's how he had to stand and fight through a garrison, of soldiers from the enemy's camp. And so if you didn't have strength in your legs, you would not be able to get involved in physical warfare. And David said, some trust in horses and some in chariots. And later on he speaks about people putting their trust in the strength of a man's legs. But I will forever remember the name of my Lord. And he produced songs like, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. And these are the kind of, this is the kind of confidence we have to bring back, because we've become so self-reliant. Or we've become so enslaved by the mentality of the culture that we come out of that we rob ourselves of understanding the blessings that comes from God. Verse 37, and because of you, the Lord became angry with me also. You shall not enter it either. You know, there's a principle here. Leaders suffer when people vote against the purposes of God. Well, we believe that Moses lost his cool. He got angry, struck the rock when God said, speak to it. And God told him not to. that you will not enter into the promised land, but this portion of scripture says that the decision of the people, and because he was over them, he was robbed of entering in because he was part of that generation. But your assistant Joshua, son of Nun, will enter it. Encourage him because he will lead Israel to inherit it. And the little ones that you said would be taken captive, your children who do not yet know good from bad, they will enter the land. So it was not just Joshua and Caleb, but every little child who was too innocent to know of the decisions of their parents. Do you know that parents are affecting sometimes the destiny of their children? Do you know that some of the bad decisions that parents make cause for their offspring, for their future generations to suffer? These kids had to wait 40 years to come into their breakthrough. They had to wait until their parents died before they could rise up to fulfill the purposes of God. I mean, that's a tragedy for me. An 11-day journey taking 40 years because the elders of families made decisions that contradicted the plan of God. But as for you, turn around and set out towards the desert, towards the route to the Red Sea, along the route to the Red Sea. Then you replied, we have sinned against the Lord. Listen to this. We will go up and fight as the Lord our God commanded us. So every one of you put on his weapons, thinking it easy to go up into the hill country. And the Lord said to me, tell them, do not go up and fight because I will not be with you. You will be defeated by your enemies. So I told you that you would not, but you would not listen. You rebelled. This is a recalcitrant culture. It's very common to the 21st century culture. A recalcitrant culture is a culture of opinion, rebellion, insubordination, resistance, unbelief, choosing your own way against the way that God has chosen for us. That's a recalcitrant culture. And it is very, very common in the church presently. And listen to what it says here. So I told you, but you would not listen. You rebelled against the Lord's command. And in your arrogance, you marched up into the hill country. The Amorites who lived in those hills came out against you. They chased you like a swarm of bees. And they beat you down from Seir all the way to Homer. You came back and wept before the Lord, but he paid no attention to your weeping and turned a deaf ear to you. And so you stayed in Kadesh many days, all the time you spent there. Then he turned back and set out towards the wilderness, along the route to the Red Sea, as the Lord directed me. For a long time, we made our way around the hill country of Seir, and we'll talk about that later on. But I had to read this into the record. I know reading scripture is not common at this length, but we must get used to the idea that the Bible can speak for itself. Okay, and we are just exponents of the scriptures. Now, here's the story, and I want you to understand it carefully as I lay the backdrop to some of the things that I want to say in ensuing weeks. The first thing is, the journey to your dominion could take 11 days. I'm speaking now metaphorically. But it can also take an indefinite period of time called 40 years. Each one of us here today must make a decision. Do I live the way I live? And in this context, it's called unbelief, it's called disobedience, it's called rebellion, or it's called thinking, developing a mindset that God hates you. That's what they said. I've heard people say in my pastoral journey, and I'm incidentally just finishing 38 years in ministry. Okay, this is our 39th year of ministry. I've heard people say, and I've dealt with people that came from other religions into the faith, that coming into the faith was even more difficult, and sometimes we wish we stayed in our previous religious backgrounds. I've heard people say that. Others would compare Christianity, those that are born in Christian families, to the fact that if you don't know how to survive, you would not succeed, and all the stuff that comes from the scriptures is just hypothetical. Very few people in the church today truly believe that the God of this Bible is deeply concerned about their well-being. For a long time as a pastor, in this 38, 39-year journey that started in 1985, for a long time, I believed that we were not called to live successfully in this life. That when we were saved, we go into an enclave, a holding cell, until Jesus came. That this world was not our own, and that our true life will begin when we die and fly away. Where we live in denial of present prophetic promises, and we postpone all of those promises to the sweet by and by. Some of us have also come to the place of realizing that yes, maybe we should live successfully, but because we do not want to take those principles that God gives us, because what God gives you does not mean it falls on your lap. What God gives you when he says, see, I'm delivering the land to you, simply means that while he's delivering it, you have to still fight for it. Nothing is given, you know, I've said this repeatedly, the things of God are free, but they're not cheap. Moses is reminding the people here, you could have had so much of privilege, so much of dominion. You could have taken these gigantic, these superpowers, these powerful people, but you adopted a position no different to being slaves in Egypt. And as a result of that, I could not go against your free will. I could not superride your negative opinions. I had to make the choice of living with your decisions because I respect the decisions of your leaders. And people like Joshua, Caleb, and some of the children that were too innocent suffered the consequences. But you know, I'm beginning to understand more and more that in the wisdom of God, that he had to also use the period of their disobedience to start to create what I call spiritual formation and to build into the lives of the people a very organized system of belief that included rules, commandments, regulations. God had to establish a government over the people. I'm beginning to see that sometimes, even though many of us are only coming much later in our walk with God to realize that life begins now, not when you die. I don't know about you, but I don't need a house in heaven. I don't need jewels in my crown in heaven. I don't need healing when I get to heaven. Why? Because my spirit will be perfect in heaven. My spirit does not need a house to dwell in. My spirit is going to be so complete that there's no illness or sickness there. But I need those things in this life because as long as I live in the flesh, I have material needs. And what God has promised us is now, not in the future. God didn't promise the nation of Israel prosperity when they die and get to heaven. God promised it to them if they knew how to take the cities or the 10 nations or the 10 people groups that dominated the area that he was giving to them. So God is telling us today, and this is the point I want to drive home today, is that I actually want to incite us to a place where you have to say to yourself, I can't live here anymore. I have to get up and do something. And many of us have trusted in our own abilities, and it's brought us to a cul-de-sac. And we are not seeing the kind of fruitfulness or effect we should be seeing simply because we've tried it in our own way. And while we may have had measures of success, but we've not had the totality of success because that only comes from God. God is a God who anoints us to generate wealth. It's a grace. It's a gifting. So salvation from bondage, from Egypt, from Babylon, from your previous religions and traditions and ways of life is only the first step in a journey where we have to come to a place of realizing that dominion, conquest, possession is an integral part of our lives. And we have to see it happening now. Do you believe that? Ask your spouse sitting next to you, if you are married. Or your future. Or just talk to the angel on the empty chair next to you. Are you ready for what God wants to do? And you know, sometimes it's our mindsets. Our biggest enemy today is our mindset. You know, I read for you here, at the beginning of the journey, this is after they came out of Egypt, God said to them, take the Amorites. Before they crossed the Jordan, take the Amorites. God wanted them to conquer these guys. And there were two kingdoms amongst the Amorites, one led by Sihon and the other by Og. Very powerful. Sihon means a king who develops strategic thinking. That's what his name, Heshbon, the place he ruled over, means. He's an inventive leader, a strategist. And the second king, his name means Og, and I will talk about that in detail. The second king's name is Og. That's a very long-necked, stiff-necked guy. And they said these kings wore a gold chain with jewelry on it. Now, I'm not referring to some groups that I know. I put those, in Joburg, you can't wear the gold chain. It's very unsafe. But in some parts of South Africa, like KZN, Maybe. But it spoke about a people of prosperity. In other words, the Amorites were ideologists. They were very educated, extremely influential. They ruled by dominating mentalities. But two mentalities had to be developed. The two kings were over two very powerful arms of these mentalities. Ideology has to become a reality. The ideal must become a real. That which is an idea must be incarnated. These two kings took what was an Amorite attitude, and they gave it latitude. They gave it flesh. The one king develop strategies, innovations, inventions. And this king was a very powerful king. I'm going to talk about how Christians have to move away from slothfulness, from complacency, from mystical ways of thinking. You know, I get all these people that they live in this cloud of unreality. They live in the surreal world where they think everything will happen by wishful thinking. They love dreams and visions, but they never see it becoming a reality. They're always looking and they're always making positive confessions. You ask them, how is life? God is good all the time. Or they will tell you it's by God's grace. But we are not thinking in a calculated way. We're not, you know, one of the things that God used the people to the nation of Israel to bring to Moses, and later on in Numbers chapter 13, Moses uses the same example when he says, God commanded me. The people came, the leaders came to Moses, and they said, can we go and study the enemy we're going to take? And Moses was, he was overwhelmed by the brilliance of the idea. And he said, yeah, let's send the 12 leaders of the 12 tribes. And he heard the voice of God in the people. And later on, Moses will say in Numbers chapter 13, God commanded me to send 12 spies, a leader from each of your tribes. So God can speak through the people. And that was strategic thinking. That was analytical thinking. That was going and doing your due diligence. And in the church today, no one does that. They don't count the cost. You want to buy a car, you count the cost. You don't just go and buy it and say, oh, by faith, I'll pay it. No, okay, I've done that in the past, but please don't follow my example. You don't go to war without knowing your enemy. You don't step into an environment without doing your analytics, your case study of it. And the one king, Sion, that's what he represented, and I'll explain that to you. The other king represented an attitude that if you want to be successful in life, you must be prosperous. Now, please forgive me for saying this, and I'm not saying it in judgment. Because I know what poverty is, and I've tasted it for most of my life until I took the decision to adopt this word. And I can't call myself a poor man anymore. Maybe poor in spirit, but I'm not poor. But I learned one thing, that when I was poor, I could not be a blessing to anyone. When I was poor, I was hoping for some rich man to give me money. When I was poor, I could not help the widow and the orphan. When I was poor, I could not give. I was embarrassed at times to drop my offering. When I was poor, I was not fruitful. I was not influential. And I could not fulfill the scriptures. It is more blessed to give than to receive. I was poor, I could not be the head, I had to become the tail. And I learned one thing about God. If he does not empower us to be rich, and I don't mean it in the sense of just material riches, and that's a part of it, but not altogether. But if it was not God's plan to be blessed, he would not have blessed Abraham, who chose a nomadic life, who lived in a tent, who walked through the land unsure of how he's going to acquire it. But as he learned to trust God, as he learned how to become fruitful, and his fruitfulness was governed by the idea that it is more blessed to obey God than to live by my own instincts for survival. Then he saw the blessings. And these two mentalities have to grip our thinking. One is, can I start to reorganize myself and become more organized, which is an apostolic principle, more orderly, more structured, more principled, which is so important to me. Your yes is yes. Your no is no. I refuse to sing a song like the songs that were sang today about what shake away my traditions. What's it? All those words? I can't remember songs. Or my religions. I'm tired of the old way. I want to live the new way. I mean, just singing it and then go back to the old ways. The old traditions, the old behavioral patterns. I want to choose your way and then I choose my way when it comes to God saying, do this and do that. It doesn't work like that. Structured thinking. And the principle of fruitfulness is that if you don't sow, you don't reap. If you don't give, you don't get. Not that you give to get. If you don't give an Isaac, you will not become father to nations. If you don't give your only son, how are you going to inherit all the sons of the earth? It's a principle. You cannot be a farmer without learning how to prepare the ground and put your seed, even though God gives the increase. These are principles. And people will try to, you know, revoke those principles by saying we live in the new covenant and choose cheap and lazy and selfish ways to justify it. And yes, you can justify it. But it will not guarantee you the kind of success that God wants to give you. So how many of you want to overcome the Amorite? You know what's the principle here? God told them this at the beginning of the journey after they sent the spies. Go and take them. But they went through the report. And they went and they looked at it through the lens of their enslaved mentality that they inherited in Egypt. And obviously they were naturalized slaves because they were baking bricks and building pyramids and doing all the inventions or discoveries of inventions for the Egyptian people. I mean, they contributed to the welfare of the whole government of Egypt, the whole kingdom of Egypt. But they came with a mentality that we are not rulers. We are slaves. We are not over things. We are under things. And some of us that's come from apartheid, we still think like that. And others of us that may have been in the system, and please, I don't want to get political here, but sometimes we think that because everyone's against us, we must just survive, we must be careful, and we become prisoners of our past, whatever that past is. And we don't realize that in Christ we are set free. It is for freedom he came, that you may be free. Free from the bondages of history. Free from the bondages of enslavement. Whatever it is. And step into this dimension of living. And so God now is bringing us to a place where we have to make some decisions. But these people could have, the Amorites, could have been taken, and God wanted them to first be taken. In other words, what do you take? You take a mentality. You take an ideology where God says, destroy the Amorite. God is saying, destroy the prevailing mentality, the cultural dominant features of the time that you're living in. Destroy that mentality. Possess it. So if the Amorite was the predominant spirit in that area, and the Amorite represented a way of thinking, then you need to overcome that way of thinking. You have to learn how to rule over mindsets, over thoughts, over principles, over principalities, over the rulers of this age, over the attitudes that are prevalent, and we need to discern those things. God wanted that. 11 days after they came back, or whatever period, they came back from spying the land, but their mentality was, no, I mean, it's easy to say I'm giving you this. But do you know how big they are? They are not just tall and huge people, but they have tall and huge walls to their cities. And even the cities that are unwalled, I mean, the towns that are unwalled, that have no walls, are so powerful, we will not survive. And they concluded that because the enemy was more powerful than them, that God hated them. They could not trust this God. Why? Because their view of a leader was Pharaoh. They could not trust him. They murmured, they complained, they hated him. So they transferred that attitude to this God, not believing that this God who brought them by a mighty hand out of Egypt, who saved them from slavery, is the same God that can take care of them in the wilderness or in the land that they have to conquer. That's the attitude that we have to adopt. Say to your neighbor, no more rebellion. You know what rebellion is? It's a disrespect for what God tells you. It's a total disrespect. It is coming against the will of God and saying, you may have your ideas, but I don't believe them. That's rebellion. And rebellion in Scripture equates to witchcraft. It means that if you say that I don't want your plan, you cannot live neutral in the world. There's no neutral position. God tells us in the book of Revelation that he hates the lukewarm, a picture of neutrality. He says, if you're neither hot nor cold, I vomit you out. That's not a very good picture. Not a good picture. There's no neutral position. You need to make a position. Rebellion means that if you reject God's plan, you've opened the door for demons to attack you. And like the bees that drove them and scattered them and made a mockery of them, so will the spirits of this world invade and dominate our lives. Choose today whether it's going to be rebellion, it's going to be unbelief, it's going to be a rejection of the will of God, or it's going to be choosing your own personal way of living. That's the point. I'm begging you today, as a church, to adopt a mentality that says, I'm going to overcome the mentality of this world. That's the Amorite spirit. That's the Western spirit. That's the hill dweller, the dominant spirit. And to adopt that, you have to then adopt two arms to this whole thing. One is, I'm going to start thinking God's way. That's the spirit of a strategist. And there's a wisdom that comes with it. Wisdom builds the house. Wisdom cuts their seven pillars. Wisdom prepares a table. Wisdom mixes a wine. Wisdom cuts a meat. Wisdom sends a fearless virgins to invite people to the table. That's strategy. God is a God of strategy. When God created all of creation, that's the heavens and the earth and everything in them, God had a six-day plan. God never does anything without strategy. If he's going to send Christ into the world, he always sends a forerunner. That's called Elijah or John the Baptist, somebody that goes to prepare the way. God always thinks, he's a forward-thinking God. He sees the end from the beginning. And the church of Jesus Christ has to come back to adopt that mind. When I talk about strategy, I'm not talking about project management. I am not talking about you drawing up your own visions and your own plans. I'm talking about prophetic sight. Where there is no prophetic sight, the people perish. I'm going to talk to you about how to develop sight into the eternal word of God so that he opens the door to you for you to see how a people are organized to rule over the earth. Are you with me? And that's called strategy. That's called inventive thinking. That's called the wisdom of God. That's called the innovation that people like Daniel and before Daniel, Joseph had and Solomon had, and how God wants that wisdom now to come upon this church. Yeah. And I will talk to you about fruitfulness, how to create bread so that we can be bread distributors in the world. The name Og and the region that he was in was a place that was known as baking cake, which means generating food, learning how to become distributors of the blessings of God. God has not made you, given you a business so that you can just get rich. Yes, there's seed for the sower and bread for the eater. God has not given you vocations and promotions so that it is for selfish gain. God is giving it to you to prepare you to cross your Jordan so you can possess and take over. No one's going to treat us serious until we get our act right on the wilderness side of the journey. Do you know what happened when they crossed over? The people in Jericho, a super city, they say you could drive a horse and trailer on the wall of Jericho. They were in fear just at the thought of these people crossing the Jordan. What happened? Their reputation was developed in the wilderness. And in the wilderness, people already started hearing about a nation crossing the Jordan to possess the land. That's the kind of people that God's going to raise up in this time. I don't know about you, but I'm excited because I think many of you are going to step into this destiny. Amen. Please stand with me. Please stand with me. If there's any feeling I want to leave with you today, it's the feeling of dissatisfaction. Not with God, but with yourselves. During the holidays, I was sitting in, I don't know if I told you this, I was sitting and looking at the ocean and thanking God for all the good things that He's given to Marolyn and myself and our family. And God said, I will bless you with so much. But if you get absorbed by the things I bless you with, it will be vanity. But if you still serve my purposes, it will be a blessing. Sometimes we get so self-absorbed with our breakthroughs that they become the place of breakdown. God has not blessed you, or He will not bless you for yourselves only. He'll bless you to fulfill His purpose on the earth. Every one of you are called to represent Him in every field of expertise, and He will give you favor in those areas so that people will listen to you when you speak. And go and study Job. When he spoke, even the princes kept quiet. The senior men in the city would not open their mouths because the wisdom that fell from his mouth answered all their problems. That's the grace that's coming upon the church. Amen. How many of you believe it's going to happen to you? Come, just lift your hands to the Lord. This is a season, not just of aggressive advancement, but now God's going to define your steps as you advance. It's going to increase favor upon your lives. He's going to prosper you. He's going to bless you. And I'm not saying it because of some positive feeling I have. I'm convicted by this. And the more I study patterns in the scriptures, the more I see that if you can only just trust God, and whatever He tells you, just do it. Don't fight it. You'd rather lose your life, but do it. And then see how God will bless you. If He puts a thought in your mind and something into your spirit, just do it. Come, lift your hands. Jim. 2024, are you ready to make a dedication to the Lord? Ready to devote your lives afresh to Him? I know some of you love God, but you still have it difficult to trust Him. But come, let's just come to a place where we throw ourselves completely into His hands. I'm If your family member is next to you or somebody that's close to you, join hands with that person. Let's pray a corporate prayer today. Amongst us, there'll always be the weak. But the strong amongst us must strengthen the weak. But our commitment must be as a collective today. Whether we're weak or strong, young or old, mature or immature, come, let's believe God together. It's a collective. This journey is a collective. A whole nation suffered because a collective decision was made. And the minority suffered because of the majority decision. These are eternal principles that we must learn from. Fathers, mothers here, make good decisions over your family today. Make a dedication. If people living with you in your home, decide how you're going to run that house. Make a decision for your marriage. Some of you that are in business or you have some powerful vocations, make a decision about how you're going to live for your business, for your career. Make some decisions. Is it your business? Is it your vocation? Or is it something that God has blessed you with to serve Him? Can you see yourself representing Him, not yourselves? That must be your surrender today. Father, this is our surrender. That we want to submit our whole lives to you. But in submitting ourselves to you, we do not want to live like those that lived in the wilderness, who chose to adopt a disposition against you of unbelief, rebellion, and challenging the leaders that were leading them, that they would not put their trust or confidence. Father, we learned today that no promises of yours can come to pass if you are not with us. And we learned from Israel that when you withdrew from them, then they chose to go and fight the Amorite and they lost. We cannot fight any battles unless the Lord is with us. We cannot do anything unless you are with us. We cannot rely upon our own selves. We have weaponized ourselves on many occasions and we have suffered defeat. But today, Lord, we want you to become our shield, our butler, our protective hedge. We want you to become everything over us, oh God. If you are for us, then who can be against us? In everything, we will be more than conquerors through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, Lord, today we dedicate our lives afresh to you at the beginning of another year. We ask, O God, that you now lead us, that we overcome the popular cultures of this world that we live in, the mentalities that override the way we want to see things. We are continuously bombarded with a worldview that attacks the view of God. And sometimes we, Lord, synchronize our lives to accept a little bit of that world and your world. But today, Lord, we want to come to a place of total separation. Bring us to a place of devotion to you. You've given us enough revelation in this place to know your will, to know your purposes for our lives. Now, Lord, help us to separate ourselves unto you and trust you. We know that it's impossible to see the kingdoms of this world fall. It's impossible to see nations bow their knee to you. It's impossible to see the church arise to establish dominion in the earth. But if you are in it, then it's possible. All things are possible to them who believe. Evil can be dispensed and removed if the righteous amongst us arise, O God. And I'm praying for righteousness to prevail and for your purposes to be fulfilled. So I bless this house. I pray that the next few weeks will be weeks of separation, that we will come to this place called Kadesh Barnea, a place of separation unto holiness, that we would become a distinct people unto you, a people who would live our lives for you and you only. So I bless this house today. I know that something is going to happen in this environment. So impregnate it with zeal, with determination. Impregnate the spirits of your people with your word. May it become the engine that energizes us and drives us into your purposes. So we thank you, Father. We thank you for hearing our prayers. Now as we prepare for the communion, we do so as again reminding ourselves that daily we should partake of this, being assured that we are people of covenant. And the covenant is that we will succeed in this life because we live the life of Christ on the earth. So I bless your people as they partake. Bless your people in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead, take those emblems and do so with the confidence that you're a people of the eternal covenant. May the Lord bless you, go in His grace, and prepare your hearts for all the things that God wants to do through you. May the grace of the Lord be with you.